Hello, and today we are actually looking at a project that I've had on hold for quite a while. Now, I've got quite a large collection of Betamax VCRs and also Betamax cassettes. And what has happened is these cassettes have been in storage, and they, as you can see from this Sony Master HD cassette here, have become damaged with a mixture of water and mould. So what I've done is I've got a Sony C5, which you can see in the background there, and I'm taking these cotton buds, or Q-tips, cutting off one end and sticking them together with some sellotape to make a bunch of cotton buds. And I'm also going to be using some rubbing alcohol in an attempt to try and rejuvenate this cassette, which really, I suppose technically, is fit for the bin, if I'm going to be honest. Now, the machine I'm using is not in the best cosmetic condition. It is a Sony SL C5 UB, which is a PAL spec machine. The cover, as you can see, is actually from a Sony C7, which is a bit strange, but there you go. But it really is sort of like a mixture of machines, bits and pieces, etc. Well, so from a cosmetic perspective, inside it's actually surprisingly clean, and once it's actually finished serving the purpose as a rig to clean cassettes, I will actually be testing its picture output to see if it's any good, and possibly using it to repair some of my other machines. So the first thing I had to do was to make sure that the machine was actually working. So we got the cover off, as you can see here, the venerable C5 inside. This machine dates from around 1981, and it really is quite an old machine by today's standards, and was very quickly outclassed when it was new. Now, the tape that I'm trying to work with is not rewinding or fast-forwarding at all. It's almost as if the reels have been stuck together with sort of a mixture of moisture and mould. So the first thing that I did was to just give the whole inside a bit of a clean out. So these rubber tyres, the heads on the head drum, and everything else, just giving it a bit of a clean. The C5 was sort of quite interesting and unique in the video recorder world. VHS machines tended to not lace up when the tape was put in, but Betamax machines always tended to keep the tape laced. It did mean that you did get very quick deck functions, sort of change between deck functions, but it also meant you had premature head wear. Later VHS machines with harder wearing heads actually went over to this method, but the Sony machines certainly used this method, as did the Toshiba and NEC Betamax clones. The Sanyo Betacords didn't. They actually kept the tape unlaced and only laced it up when you were sort of playing the tape. If you were rewinding or fast-forwarding, the tape was unlaced. Now, what I've done is I've actually tipped the machine up and just basically tipped everything out, as there was a load of bits of newspaper in there and shards of paper from when the machine was sent to me. The machine itself only cost me about £5 or so, so I thought it was ideal for this particular sort of purpose. But when I actually got inside it, I found that the belts were in relatively good shape. They've certainly been replaced at some point in the machine's life, and there has been a point in this machine's life where it has been looked after and serviced, which sort of, you know, sort of really gives me a feeling that I should actually be doing something with this once this task is finished. You will notice to the bottom left corner of the screen there is a part of the circuit board that's actually broken off. There aren't actually any components on that part of the circuit board, and it's just where the track actually goes and meets up the screw that screws that board back into the machine. So I got the machine sealed up again, and I was going to try the cassette again just to see, after giving everything a clean, if that would actually kick things back into life. As you can see, this is all the crap that came out of the machine. It's mainly just shards of paper from where the machine was packed. So with the machine back over again, I wanted to see if I could actually get the cassette itself to rewind. Now, I tested the machine without the tape cradle in place, and there is quite literally just a single switch that you have to press down, which will allow the machine to lace up and will allow all of the various functions to operate. It's a little bit different to VHS machines, which have a video lamp which needs to be, I believe, covered over to actually get the machine to operate. The Betamax system uses a pressure switch which tells the machine that the tape is in, and instead of using a video lamp and clear tape leaders to tell you that the tape has rewound or has got to the end, it uses metal tape leaders which run past a effectively sort of a little sensor on each side, which tells the machine that the tape is at the end or the tape is at the beginning. So obviously if it's fast forwarded or rewound, it tells you where it is. What I did with this tire was I actually took the little tire off and just gave it a filing down evenly, just to make it a little bit rougher, so it actually sort of had a bit of a chance of making contact with the spool itself and actually spinning things round. Once I had the cradle out, I actually tested it without the tape in place, and there is quite a bit of torque on the actual spool itself, and that led me to this stage now where I'm actually dismantling the cassette. So all Betamax cassettes, as far as I know, have got four screws holding the two halves of the cases together. The setup is a little bit different to VHS cassettes in that there is a tape breaking system in there, but it's on the top half of the cassette case on both sides, and it's actually released by releasing the flap at the top there. So just above my fingers you can see the flap. The flap is released, and that releases both the little plastic breaking mechanisms, which allows you to manually turn the spools if you so desired. On the VHS machines, it's down at the bottom in between the spools, and there's a pin in a VHS machine that sort of releases the tape breaking mechanism inside the cassette. So what I've actually done is I'm just taking the cassette spools out of the machine. And what I was going to do is to effectively sort of try and hand wind the tape spools back, but then I hit upon the idea of why don't I use the machine to do this job for me. So I got the spools out, which I'm just sort of carefully doing here. So if you see, I'm gradually getting the spools out, splitting the two halves of the case apart there, so you can see the spools there, and you can see that one on the right where the tape is sort of wound into. It's just caked full of something. I don't know what it is. It's mould, moisture, etc. The actual surface of the tape itself almost has sort of like water droplet stains on it, so it really isn't in the best of shape, and it's I think it is pretty much one of the worst that I've got, but I wanted to see if I could actually get anything off of the tape itself. So this is why I spent a bit of time trying to get this to actually work and trying to get it to clean. So as you can see here, I initially thought, oh, I'll just manually wind it. And it didn't take me long to realise that that's just going to take ages. I mean, you're looking at an L500 cassette there, so you're looking at about, L500's about 2.5 hours or so. So you're looking at 2.5 hours of time. Oh, actually, I'll need to double check that. I think L500 may have been 2 hours. L750s were 3 hours 15 minutes. This is going by PAL timings, or in NTSC world, the Beta 2 speed, which was the speed that all machines used after, I can't remember, I think it was 1978 or so. So anyway, what I did was I used one of my cleaning swabs and just gradually placed it underneath the spool itself on the left-hand side. So that's the one closest to the bottom of the picture. Activated the machine, and I was able to pretty much rewind and fast forward the machine a number of times with these open spools in place. And I was able to press a mixture of the cotton buds and the swab against the tape itself. Now you can see here that the material that's obviously sort of clung to the tape over these years is beginning to shed, and it's beginning to actually come away from the tape surface itself. I'm not sure what it is. It's like a combination of dust and mould and other residue that seems to have got onto this tape. So I did a few more times on the rewind and fast forward functions of the machine, going through trying to get the all of this mould stuff covered off. I used a whole packet of these swabs. Incidentally, the swabs I'm using are actually normally used for cleaning CCD sensors on high-end SLR digital cameras. But because they are pre-treated with an isopropyl alcohol-type substance, they're actually ideal for what I want to do here, and they've got nice, soft, flat surface, which is ideal for running the tape up against. So what will happen if you're doing this particular method is you will find that the tape, because there's obviously no braking mechanisms in play, no tensioning mechanisms, but it starts to rewind unevenly. Now, what I did whilst the tapes were despooled, or rather, despooled like this, is when one side was wound, I would clean out the other side using some tissue paper and some rubbing alcohol, and then repeat the same process on the other side. I also thoroughly cleaned out the inside of the actual cassette housing itself that the cassette will go back into, just to get rid of any sort of errant spores that may have been languishing in there. It's up to you what you do as regards facial protection. You might want to get yourself a face mask, because you don't know what kind of spores are floating around when you're sort of doing this particular cleaning exercise. And also you just want to be careful with the isopropyl alcohol that you're going to be playing with. Now, this sequence here is actually the final rewind of the tape whilst it's out of the final rewind of these two spools whilst they're out of the tape case itself. Oh, something I forgot to mention. Bottom left hand of the picture, you can see those two glass fuses. That's actually the main power supply board in the machine. You can actually see that huge heatsink, which I think a couple of rectifiers are bolted onto. You want to be careful not to rest your hand on there. Throughout this process, I was resting my hand on that particular area. And just looking back at this, I am actually very lucky I didn't hit one of those fuses, because they are live and there is a certain amount of voltage, probably 220 to 240 volts pulsing through those. So just be a bit careful where you're putting your hand, etc. You may want to cover that area with, say, a piece of plastic or something, so you can rest a hand on there as you need to. So you can wedge the thing in to sort of activate the machine. You can also use a bit of blue tack as well to wedge it down, but I went for the method I used because I didn't want to get the machine itself full of blue tack and gummed up, because there are parts on this machine that I'll probably want to use at some point in the future. And to be perfectly honest with you, if this whole machine is healthy, I'll probably just be reshelling my poorly C5 onto this one, and then taking some time to probably repair my other C5, which is another project in itself. So I still found, when trying to fast forward this particular cassette, that it was a little bit sticky coming near the end of the cassette's run. I'll be honest, I'm not sure why that is. The only thing I can think of is the tape is a little bit sticky after sort of going through and having all of the solvent placed on it, so probably it just needs a bit of time to dry. And what I may actually should have done has left those spools out in the open for a bit longer, just to make sure that they're fully dried up. Now, I did actually find that I was in the end actually able to get the tape to fast forward completely, and once that was done, I just gave it another full rewind back to the beginning of the cassette. And as you can see there, you can see the red tape leader coming out, and we're now starting to rewind the cassette. So on the final rewind, I pressed the swab against the part of the tape that's going to be in contact with the video heads, as you can see there. And that really is just the sort of the final cleaning exercise before we go on to test. You can already see, sort of in this sequence, that the tape is a lot cleaner than it was, and there's no, or certainly very little mould left on the cassette itself. The last thing that I did was to power off the machine and just put the cover back onto the machine. Just put everything sort of generally back together, and then put the deck itself back into storage. For some reason, there was no
Hey
tape
Devin.
lid on there, so I just
Yo.
covered it over with some tissue.
Um,
This is playback of the cassette itself.
I haven't
Now,
gotten
for playback, I'm using
my phone
my
charged
Sanyo
the same
Betacord
way
M20,
in
VTC M20 Beta machine.
a month.
The sound itself, there is, it is quite muffled. The picture, as you can see, isn't fantastic. There's quite a bit of noise on it, but you can, you can make out what's going on. I mean, this particular film, for some reason, is Fight Club. It's not an original copy of Fight Club, as I've got an original VHS copy, and I wanted to experiment with copying over to Betamax to see if it could be done. So, some a little tip that trick that a lot of people sort of salubrious pursuits used to do is they actually used to have either very early Ferguson 3V22 or JVC machines in place, or Sony Betamax machines, because of the way the auto gain control worked on those sort of sets of machines, the Betamax and the early VHS decks, it actually cancelled out the macrovision control mechanism. So you could actually use a Betamax machine to pirate a cassette. Obviously, I don't recommend it because it's highly illegal, but I had the original VHS media, and I wanted to see how things actually worked and if it would actually do it. You can actually see as you go later through the cassette, which I've done here, the picture is actually a lot better. Ignore those blanking lines. It's a CRT television, so you do get blanking lines when you're filming. But on the whole, the picture was getting better the more you watched the video itself. It would be interesting to actually go back and start watching again from the beginning, because there may have been some residual oxide on the cassette that was clogging up the video heads on my sturdy Betacord machine. So there we go. I've got a number of other cassettes to do, which I will be doing at some point. But I hope this video proves useful to someone. If you've enjoyed this video, don't forget to hit that like button. And also consider subscribing for more upcoming fascinating hobbies. Thank you very much for watching.